गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू अवर ऑनलाइन सेशन ऑफ ऑप्टिकल कम्युनिकेशन क्लास। इन टुडे सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू कवर द मोड्स ऑफ सिलेंड्रिकल वेवगाइड्स विच वी आर यूजिंग इन द ऑप्टिकल कम्युनिकेशन। दिस टॉपिक वी आर गोइंग टू कवर एंड मोर ओवर वी आर गोइंग टू कम्प्लीट दीज आर द अवर बेसिक टॉपिक्स। ओके, द फर्स्ट वन द बेसिक प्रिंसिपल ऑफ लाइट प्रोपगेशन, द सेकेंड वन न्यूमेरिकल अपर्चर एंड एक्सेप्टेंस एंगल, थर्ड वन mode theory, the fourth one mode in planar waveguides, morph condition, and at the end we are going to use the TE and TM modes. What is TE stands for? Electrical mode. TM stands for magnetic mode. So both the modes we are going to cover in today's sessions. Okay, so before proceeding with that, I just want to take a quick recap what we discussed in the previous session. So we discuss about what we discuss, students. So we talk about the difference types of modes. We talk about, we have seen the single light source and multi light source we have seen, and even we talk about the difference of your sources as well. So students, so we talk about the different sources of light as well. So now we are proceeding with the basic principle of light propagation. So basically, how do we light get propagated, what are the conditions we do have for total internal reflection? This two only, just an example over here. Once again, you see, if you know that one, then only the further classes can be understandable for you for in an easier way. As the angle of incidence is increasing, when the angle of reflection become 90 degrees, suppose this is an angle of reflection we do have, it become 90 degrees, then it is called critical angle. Critical angle is given by phi c is equals to sine inverse of n2 by n1. N2 stands for refractive index of second medium, n1 stands for refractive index of first medium. To get the total internal reflection, the condition over here what we do have is phi is equals to phi c. Okay, that's the condition we do have, so we need to see that one as well. Next concept we do have, students, so we do have a concept of your optical fiber which is going to work as a cylindrical waveguides that guides the light in a direction parallel to its axis. So today we are complete discussion is about your cylindrical waveguides. That is important question, they will definitely ask in the exam to derive the cylindrical waveguides concepts. Clear? For that, what we need to keep in our mind, we have to see the diagram. As you can see in the diagram, it consists of three cylinders, right? One is the core, second is the cladder, third is a buffer coating. So by using these three concepts, it's going to work on it. Now core, we know it, it's a dielectric cylinder of radius a and index of n1. To get the core, there's a condition n2 should be less than n1. The core is surrounded by the cladder that has a refractive index of n2 with the condition n2 should be less than n1. So what is n2 stands for? For cladding refractive index, n1 is core refractive index. As you can see in the diagram with the wave at the end, as you can see in the slide, the operation is based on total internal reflection to confine the light, whatever the lights we are confining. For confining that particular part, we are going to see that. Clear? So as you can see, the index fiber of a gradient fiber, so this is actually based upon their application part, based upon their working on it, based on how it is going to work and everything. So it is going to work in this way. So the refractive index of a core is uniform always, as you can see in the diagram. So when I want to find refractive index n of r, that depends upon the cladding, and core is the higher one. So n1 is for core, n2 is for cladding. Delta is what? N1 minus N2 by N1. That is called index difference. So if you want to cross multiply N1, take cross multiply, cancel. N1, N1 gets cancelled. N2 by N1 you can write. If you cross multiply, you got in this way. So N2 is equals to N1 into 1 minus delta. So always delta should vary with respect to this particular form. What is that particular form? Delta is very small. Typically, the value of typical value for delta is always ranging between from 0.2% till 3%. Based upon that, it is going to vary. So in this case, the refractive index of the cladding can be written. For the cladding, how do we write that refractive index, student? So for getting the cladding, N2 is equals to N1 into 1 minus delta. Always that value should be less than N1 because this is N2 value, no? As we have seen in the previous slide, what I shown over here, what actually we discussed in the previous slide, we said that, right? This is a point, we wrote it, right? So N2 always less than N1. For that particular value, we can say that this is what cladding refractive index, this is what core refractive index. So similarly, for the next concept, the same point I am writing here in terms of N2. Whatever N2 value we do have, we are writing in this form, right? So n2 is equals to n1 into 1 minus delta, because this is n2 value, no, is less than n1. So based upon the previous conditions, we are writing in this form. Okay, so this is the condition we are putting. After that, we just want to write it down the value. That's how we wrote it, student. So that's the reason we mentioned that. Let us see the next one. What we do have, we need to see the graph. We need to keep in our mind whenever we want to draw the graph. No, we always have to see the graph values. So next we have, students, the ray optic analysis of light wave by using the propagation in an optical fiber. This is actually the propagation mode. How do we get to get the light wave propagation in optical fiber? This is the way we will get. So for normal part, suppose you do have the normal one. So how do we get, see in the diagram how we do have it this way? It is a normal, right? So when we take a normal value from there, it is going to work on it. So based upon that, a simple analysis of propagation of light in. So this is what simple analysis. You need to write down this heading. If they ask in the exam, design by simple analysis of a light propagation in multimode step index fiber. If they ask in that, you can mention in this way. Or a single light source also, if they ask, you can mention in that way. Okay. So this approach is valid since the core size is always for multimode fiber is approximately 100 micrometer. This is for core. What about the wavelength for that? So it is much larger than the wavelength of light. Typically, what is the wavelength of light always? It is approximately equals to 1 micrometer. So this is the wavelength of our light. Micro in the sense, how much, students? It is 10 power minus 6. The obtained solution are approximated. An exact analysis must be based on the electromagnetic theory, right? By using the EMTL concepts, we do have further equation that is called Maxwell equations. We are taking the Maxwell equation for our waveguides. Okay, that will be useful in all kind of communication. If you talk about microwave communication, if you talk about optical communication, if you see any kind of communication, there is only the equation we are going to use. The two types of rays that can propagate in a fibers are meridional ray and skew ray. Okay, these are the two waves. This is the first example is for meridional, second is for the skew. What is the difference you see in, students, as you can see here, right? So propagate in a plane that contain a center axis in the fiber. See, this is our center axis. It is propagating in the center axis only. This is called meridional rays. What about the second one? It is what, skew. So as you can see here, it's a skew, right? So skew means instead of going directly, what is that? It is not confined to a single plane. They follow a helical type path along the fiber. This is called helix. In the helix form, it is going to propagate. It has a coaxial cable over there. It has a core and then cladder. The next type, students, so what is the bond rays? How do we get the bond rays? So based upon that rays, it's been classified into two parts. One is bonded ray, another is unbonded ray. What is the meaning of bonded ray, students? So these are trapped in the core and propagates along the fiber core. So trap means the sense, you, this is a principal axis we do have. We are passing a light ray over here. When it touching the surface, it is getting reflected, right? So again, if you see the angle, instead of going directly, it's getting deviated. This is what? Bonded, right? The trap in the core propagate along the fiber core. So this is what bonded. Unbonded means what? Are reflected out of the fiber core. So this is getting the reflected out. This state is what? Bonded. This is what? Unbonded. What is the total internal reflection? We know from the critical angle, no? Sin phi is equals to sin inverse of n2 by n1. If you had phi value, suppose initially it's theta, it is making a complementary angle, that is 90 minus theta. What will get? Sin 90 minus theta, cos theta, right? So cos theta is always greater than or equals to n2 by n1. This is for core cladding interface. So we know by identity, no? Sin theta plus cos theta is equals to 1. If you want to write sin theta here, cos theta shift on right side, it is 1 minus cos square theta we can write. So sin theta is equals to under root of 1 minus cos square theta. We had cos square theta value, this one. We can substitute here and we can find sin theta as well as the cos theta. In the problem, they asked to find theta, sin theta, cos theta. We can substitute in this way. So by using Snell's law, we can apply, you know, n sin theta naught is equals to n1 sin theta. So n sin theta naught as it is, what is sin theta we found, student? This is the value, right? Less than or equals to n1 into this factor. Because n1 as... So students, we apply the Snell's law and we found n sin theta naught is less than n1, 1 minus n2 by n1 whole square 1 by 2. What is 1 by 2? By applying this identity. The next we are going for the numerical aperture. So basically, numerical aperture is, what is the definition of numerical aperture? It is defined as
Na is equals to n sin theta naught maximum. Means whatever the value we find for sin theta naught, that needs to be maximum. Or is equals to n1 square minus n2 square whole power 1 by 2. This is our formula we had. Okay. So for that formula, what I can do for this, we have to write the value n1 square minus n2 square. For this, what I can write, students? A square minus B square. What is A square minus B square? A plus B into A minus B. What is this n1 actually? Where we got the student? This is n, right? So this n I am keeping as it is. I am writing as n1. As we have seen in the previous section, right? So what we have written in the previous section, we have seen this thing, right? N sin theta naught is less than or equals to n1 into 1 minus n2 by n1 whole square. By 1 you take cross multiply n1 square minus n2 square by n1 square. n1 n1 gets cancelled. So we left with one n1 that I am keeping as it is. So here we got numerical aperture is n sin theta naught maximum. For this what I can write? m1 square minus n2 square whole power 1 by 2. A square minus B square is A minus B into A plus B. We are multiplying dividing by n1. Right? So what I will get now, student, tell me? n1 as it is, whatever the minus is there, we are neglecting this negative term because our n1 is greater than or equals to n2. So this factor will be neglected. So that's what? This neglection factor, what I am writing? If I want to neglect that one, I can write that is nothing but delta, no? So this is what delta factor. So n1 minus n2 I can write as delta. That is what? Difference between these two parts, right? We already have seen the previous classes. The previous part I have shown you the delta, the first one. Here. What is delta actually? n1 minus n2 by n1, right? So this factor I am substituting over here. So that value I have substituted and got that whole power 1 by 2 or n. If you just take n1 plus n2, if both the values, suppose we are keeping approximately both are equal, then n1 plus n1, I can write 2n1. So this n1 into n1, n1 square. Square root gets cancelled. The numerical aperture what we left is, n1 n1 square root gets cancelled for that, n1 outside. 2n delta is root there, 1 by 2 is there, that is called root. So this is the approximate value for numerical aperture. Clear? So you need to get that one to simplify and to get the numerical aperture for finding the step index fiber. Clear? So numerical aperture described by this approximation and it's valid in the typical case always. For the typical value, what is delta value? Delta value is much less than 1. So now numerical aperture describe the light acceptance or gathering capability of a fiber. So typically value of numerical aperture ranges from 0.14 to 0.50. This is a typical value for numerical aperture. Clear? So now as you can see in the diagram, what we are able to see from over here, we are seeing that, see here, we had one acceptance cone, right? This is what we have taken one cylinder. What we are finding in this? Numerical aperture that can describe this typical value, then only the ray that lie within a certain acceptance cone whose vertex is on the point of incidence of the ray and opening angle is this. 2 sin inverse of numerical aperture can be propagated through the fiber. How it is getting propagated? If you do have a cone at the starting, that is called acceptance cone. And it is taking the unguided ray and it is passing to the guided ray. If you want to find both of them, we can.
So students, so we are proceeding with the numerical aperture. So what we have seen in the numerical aperture till now, we have seen the acceptance cone, right? So what is the acceptance cone we can write? So we can write acceptance cone in this way, that it has the angle from there to sin inverse of this particular angle, it is going to open it and it has a core and cladding. Next part we are going to see is the gradient index fibers. What is the gradient index fiber, students? So how do we get the gradient index fiber? To get the gradient index fiber, what we need to see? We need to see the numerical aperture, which is a function of position of the point of incidence. So when we pass the point of incidence, when you want to see that one from the ray, that for the gradient index fiber, we are going to consider in this way. Let us consider for gradient index fiber, how do we get the local numerical aperture? So this is given by NAR. It's R is nothing but like a function we do have. How do we design that one? So to design this, we are considering a point on the core and facing having a radial axis R. So see here, this is the axis we do are considering. This is our cone is there. So in that, I want to find out how do we take it. So for getting that one, I consider this is axis on the fiber, a light ray incident on the fiber, we propagate it within the local numerical aperture Na of R, which is defined for Na of R is equals to same
n square of r minus n2 square whole power 1 by 2. Okay, so na of, suppose initial condition I'm taking as 0. What is initial condition? It is 0. Under root of 1 minus r by alpha whole power alpha. So what is this alpha actually? It's called angle. Right? We have to consider that particular angle. So where axial numerical aperture is defined by this factor. Na of 0. What is na of 0 actually? N1 square will take, no, in the previous condition. That I am writing as n square of 0. Because it's a 0 condition. Wherever I is there, put the 0. N2 square whole power 1 by 2. Those is approximately equals to this whole thing if you do. It will be N1 root of 2 delta. Right? So this is what you need to remember. And always note that Na of A is always 0. Clear? Therefore, the numerical aperture of gradient index fiber decreases from Na of 0 to 0. As R move from fiber axis to the core cladding boundary. So this is called it as the core cladding boundary. You need to keep in your mind and you have to remember whenever we are taking the value for it. Next, mode theory. So what is the mode theory actually? So it's going to explain you how the ray theory is used to describe the propagation of light along an optical fiber. Whenever we do have an optical fiber, how it is going to work on it? What are the things it's going to consider? That is called it as mode theory. The mode theory also uses the electromagnetic wave behavior to describe the propagation of light along a fiber. So along the fiber, how the light is going to propagate by using the EM wave, we are going to consider that one. Next is light propagation or wave guides. What is the light propagation? So for that, you just want to see one particular diagram. Just a moment. So it's somewhat it's blur because it's, I've enlarged that picture. So let's just see this another picture. I'll explain it when it's coming. Yeah, before doing that one, you just see first this part. That is mode thin planar waveguide. So whenever we do have a plain waveguide, basically what is the waveguide actually? It's going to take the optical wave which can be used for electric field distribution in x direction. And should not have any what we call changes in z direction as well. What is this? What is the point I'm writing? The optical waveguide is effectively confined within the guide, means within that particular boundary, and the electric field distribution in this particular axis. Suppose x direction I'm taking does not change as the wave propagation in z direction. If it is propagating in x direction, should not reflect on z direction. A stable field distribution in x direction with only a periodic z dependence of that particular part is called mode. Means whatever the stable field we are considering for distribution of x direction with only a periodic z dependence. So students, so we are going to see the acceptance angle and the core and cladding part. So this is what 2 sine inverse of numerical aperture. That is what we have learned. Next is how do we find out the numerical aperture, how it is going to get the function. So this is what, so whenever we want to consider a point on core end and having a radial distance r from the axis of fiber, a light ray incidence on this point will propagate if it is within the local numerical aperture. How do we design the local numerical aperture? That can be designed by considering this expression. Numerical aperture r is equals to n square of r minus n2 square whole power 1 by 2. For that, this is the initial condition, na numerical aperture of 0. So how do we get that 0 value actually? This is what? N1 square minus N2 square we could keep, right? Always. So this is what? N square of 0 with N2 square whole power 1 by 2. This is nothing but initial condition for local numerical aperture. This is just like a formula you need to remember. So this, how do we get this factor? This is what the previous condition we found, no? 1 minus under root N2 square minus N1 whole square. That we are making in terms of local numerical aperture that we are modifying as R by alpha whole power alpha. Okay? So this, if you simplify further, at the end, we have to get this factor. So you need to learn that the whatever the axis numerical aperture we do have, that is approximately equals to N1 under root of 2 delta. So initially, this is Na of 0. So always, whatever the value will keep it, if you want to find Na of small a, is equals to 0. So what we conclude from all these things? The main conclusion part. What we concluding in that? We are concluding that numerical aperture of gradient index fiber decreases from Na of 0 to 0 as R moves from fiber axis to core cladding boundary. This core cladding boundary we will consider and we'll try to find out that numerical aperture. Okay. okay? So whenever we design that one, we have to remember it is going to be work on that particular format only, okay? So for that particular part, we need to remember it is going to work for finding that particular format which is going to be used for our numerical aperture. So in order to proceed with modes in the planar waveguide, we are going to use this numerical aperture concepts and we are going to find out its modes. Okay, the optical wave is effectively confined within the guides and electrically field distributed in x direction. So now we are finding the modes in that particular waveguide. So in order to get that one, we are using this phenomena. So next, the stable field distribution in x direction with only a periodic z direction is dependent on that mode. So whatever the field we are writing for the x direction, it depends on the z dependence, then it is called as mode. Okay, so what we are learning in this, students, so this is called mode in planar waveguides. This is all the theory we had for waveguides. So the specific mode is obtained only when the angle between the propagation vectors or the rays and the interface has to be a particular value. For that particular value only, if the interface can be obtained. So hence, at the end, what we can conclude for that, the light propagates within the guide is formed. So whenever we want to find that guide's value for it, so it is going to obtain in this format. So to get that one, we are considering one Maxwell's equation, students. This is what Maxwell's equation, no? You already know about it. Faraday's law and Gauss laws. So what is the Maxwell equation is all about? It states that when you consider a fiber optics, which will be the Maxwell equation for the light. This is the light propagating in an isotropic dielectric material with no free charges. So when we don't have any free charges, del cross E is equals to minus dou B by dou T, or del dot D is equals to zero. For Ampere's law, Gauss law, what it says that del cross H is equals to dou D by dou T, or del dot B is equals to zero. As you can see in the diagram, whatever the lines, these are vertical line, no? These are magnetic field. Whatever this line, these are called electric field. Both are mutually perpendicular, right? So green indicates magnetic field, red indicates electric field. When we take a magnetic field and electric field into consideration, when you try to find out the relation for that, that can be obtained by considering these kind of diagrams. This is what for H10 mode, 10 mode. The down is what? Electric 11 mode. So in this, what we are seeing? We are seeing again, no? This blue line is what? The magnetism which is getting occurred over there. So green indicates what? Which lines? Magnetic field. And this is what? Electric field. So this is how your Maxwell's equation can be used for isotropic dielectric material. So when you want to take the light propagation in isotropic means all direction, right? For all direction it is going to propagate. That is called isotropic dielectric material. It is taking the light propagation of it and it is going to find out the value for it. Next is, and the relation between the field types for same kind of isotropic material with no free charges. Whenever we do have a free charges, we will substitute. When we don't have, then what we will do? We know that D is equals to epsilon E, B is equals to mu H. These are relations we have. If you substitute and if you take the wave equation for that, del cross E is equals to mu E, dou square E by dou T square. You have already learned this concept in electromagnetic theory. Only we are using the application part of it. So you should have to remember these equations in order to understand the further concepts. So this actually used to find wave equation that can be formed by using whatever the above value we had, and we find the vector identity methods. This is vector identity method. If I want to take del cross E, it's mu epsilon del square E by dt square.